I would like to move on to our panel discussion on the subjects that we have planned for. What we would like to discuss today here is manufacturing in India. How effective is Make in India, and how could we evaluate Make in India for solar industry in general? We would also talk about anti-dumping duties, safeguards duties. We'll talk about off-grid applications, the importance of quality of equipment, and technologies in solar. Would like to start with Pradeep Ji, since majority of the panel members here are coming from the manufacturing segment. Would like to take up the first subject as manufacturing in India, and in terms of the exponential growth that is seen recently and challenges that we are able to foresee now. How do you see what actions, what parameters, actions should be taken by all of us as manufacturers for Make in India to be successful?
Make in India for solar has been slow in the sense the growth, the rate at which the industry is growing and the rate at which the manufacturing sector is growing in India there is a huge gap. So definitely there is a very good scope for manufacturing to grow to meet the demand. If you see today, in terms of panels, 90% of the panels today are imported into India. So that is the kind of scope that is available for Indian manufacturers to start growing exponentially. But also what is lacking today is the entire supply chain, which is the supply chain starting from polysilicon up to the modules. The entire value chain is not there in India. So this ecosystem has to parallelly grow for the manufacturing to really grow, because today we have cells, modules, we have cells, wafers again we have to import. Tomorrow you make wafers, again you have to depend on ingots for import, then again to polysilicon. So there is a huge gap, and what is required for the manufacturers to really grow in manufacturing is government support is very important. More not by way of putting anti-dumping duty or safeguard duty, but supporting them in terms of providing low-cost loans, then incentivizing in different ways, then also supporting them by giving the power, which solar manufacturing is a power intensive manufacturing, so the cost of power has to be low enough for the Indian manufacturers to become competitive. This is with respect to solar panels. Of course, other products, on-grid inverters, off-grid inverters, there is a very good scope still. So a lot of foreign players are now wanting to get into manufacture in India. So there is a very good scope. So I think these are the two major components where manufacturing in India has a very good scope.
Thank you. Vinayji, could we have your thoughts on this subject?
See, I fully agree with that. Definitely there is a lot of scope when we talk of 20 gigawatt of installations still did, and last year we added around 8 gigawatt of capacity. And it's really glad to know that solar contributed the most as far as if we consider the total energy mix last year. So total renewable energy is contributing around 19% to the total energy mix in India, and out of which solar is presently around 6%. So from the statistics point of view, we see, yes, things are happening, things are very rosy, 8 gigawatts until 20 gigawatts. But when we compare these figures to the manufacturing base what we have, so currently if we see cell, we are having a capacity of around 3 gigawatt, and I doubt out of which more than 1.5 gigawatt is operational. Similarly, if we look at the module sector, it is comparatively better, wherein we have a manufacturing capacity of around 8 gigawatt, and more than 3 gigawatt is operational. So what Pradeep ji rightly mentioned is that we are processing post wafer. So manufacturing based in India starts from cell, basically which are processing wafers into the cells. Then further, we are assembling cell into modules. So as far as government support is concerned, everybody knows that we are importing close to 90% of our module requirements. So in fact, from the manufacturing perspective, I would like to highlight one thing that in fact, manufacturers are not doing very well over in India compared to their Chinese counterparts. We have been bleeding. There are various reasons for it. There is no clear-cut guidelines in terms of any kind of monetary supports from the government side, which if it is there, definitely it is going to help the manufacturing sectors. But see, modified SIP was launched around 2009. SIP initially was launched around 2009. After that, modified SIP was launched further 5 years down the line. But nothing concrete has been done. We have been talking about numbers. We have been talking about 100 gigawatt of hour, but nothing in terms of the quality. Since the projects has to last for 25 years, are we investing really much in technology? We are basically processing cells into modules, and that too mainly multicrystalline and monocrystalline. We have very few functional units which are doing really good work in PERC cells or maybe glass to glass kind of modules. So in terms of the technology also, we have to see that we compete with the best in the world. And there are other complications also in terms of the functionalities also. We have been facing for the last a year almost. First we saw the, in July last year, the GST was launched. So it's a good that you have a unified kind of structure across the country. But when it is operational, it leads to a lot of difficulties. We see there are different kind of tax structures across the different chains in solar, wherein one component is taxed at a different rate and another component is taxed at a different rate. And even for a same component which is used in different application, it attracts a different tax structures. So that phase is still not over. That credit of GST are still pending, which is ultimately leading to the increased working capital cost for the manufacturers. And of late, we have been hearing a lot about anti-dumping duty and the safeguard duties. So this all this scenario has led to the state of instability in the market, which is ultimately, I would say, has stalled the market right now. So with these kind of things being taken care of and side by side, if there is some kind of support, not just financial support, but in terms of the technology aggregation also, and maybe government can set up some kind of funds wherein we work in some kind of research in collaboration with some research institutes, and maybe we upgrade our technology based on some kind of financial incentives from the government. These are the things which will definitely help the boosting manufacturing sector in India. Thank you.
Thank you, Anik. I think it's also about, we'll come to you, sir. We will come to you. I think it's also about a lot of times we keep talking about what government has to do for a certain sector to pick up, and we keep evaluating how much of that has been done by the government or by specific bodies or by specific nodal agencies. But many times we miss out on evaluating ourselves, that have we been able to contribute something to move, make this momentum? Let's think about solar industry. We are probably at the same place where IT industry was around late 90s. And the exponential growth that IT industry has seen and the bubble breaker has ensured that only sustainable models have sustained. Probably something similar can happen in solar industry. We are at that stage of being exponential growth, and majority of us have jumped the way in late 90s. Everybody, every nook and corner, there was a dot-com company, and every nook and corner, there was a IT training institute. Not many of them are even seen today. I don't see anything different happening in solar industry today. Every next person we see becomes an electrical contractor, or every next person becomes an EPC, without even understanding the whole depth of it. We all have thought EPC is the only opportunity in this industry, but if we really start thinking, are there other opportunities? We could get into manufacturing, we could get into after-sale service, we could build an excellent service network across India, which is currently missing, and for which we have to depend on imports. If all of us come together, start thinking ourselves that if I have to invest my time, money, energy, efforts into something, how can it be helpful and probably independent of anybody else? If this size and scale can improve, probably government will also be forced to implement policies which motivate these things, which happened in retail industry, which happened in automotive industry, which happened in IT industry. And the time is not far if platforms like this bring our like-minded people together to build ourselves as a force to fuel the growth of this industry. Let's think differently. Let's plan our time, money, energy, and to be invested in this industry in such a way that brings growth for all of us, not cutthroat competition among ourselves. On this note, would like to move on to the next subject, as to would like to have Suresh ji's opinion on, with so much of being spoken about what government should do, what we should do, and how there are challenges into this. What do you think is the role of quality in manufacturing?
Yep.
Especially with the solar context.
Yeah, actually, being a manufacturing company, we Tata BlueScope Steel presently supporting in designing and supplying of a structure, supporting structure for ground-mounted solar structures. And slowly we are also involving in the research and development of rooftop solar. But we are truly speaking, we are facing some challenges in the manufacturing of our solar structures. The first challenge is the timeline. The timeline now, when we started this business in 2011 in supplying the structures, that time it was 100 tons per megawatt. That kind of a design we designed. Now, though the rates dropped down to 3.47, from that time it was around 14 rupees. And now because of that, the tons per megawatt comes down to 30 tons roughly. Yeah, 27 also. I'm telling 30, and we recently supplied one in for 26 tons also. Just imagine that the way we drop down the design analysis, all these things, we reduce the structural weight. See, basically what happened, this is not only simply we can't reduce that, it depends upon the wind speed and environmental conditions. We are straight away reducing the earlier stages. We went with the HR sections of 5 mm, 6 mm. Now we are going with 0.9 mm, 0.85 mm. Luckily, our Tata BlueScope Steel is capable of manufacturing zinc alum coated steel, which is actually 4 times more durable than the galvanized steel. So for example, galvanized steel 550 GSM coated with some 2 mm is designed for that. Our material is a 150 GSM of aluminum and zinc alum coated with the thickness of 0.85 and with the yield strength of 550 megapascals. So with that high strength steel, we are capable of achieving this 26 to 30 tons per megawatt. But the challenge here, basically, because of the timeline, the manufacturing capacity is brought down. Because of the thickness reduces, ton per shift reduces. With the given timeline, it is very difficult to manufacture and supply. The major impact what we see is, it's other than the regular structural design, this particular solar structure needs the precision, precision in quality. Because the hole-to-hole distance, generally we keep plus or minus 2 mm in other structural things. But here you need to fix your solar PV model exactly to the drilled hole, which is also 6 mm, 7 mm dia. So we had to produce the hole-to-hole distance of plus or minus 0.5 mm, where no machines will produce it right now. Having Americans and New Zealand machines in Tata BlueScope Steel, we actually took the help of our machine manufacturers, and we fine-tuned our machines to brought down to this 0.5 mm, plus or minus 0.5 mm precisions, which actually taking some more time, the productivity loss. So these are all the challenges we are actually facing during manufacturing. Apart from that, the pre-punched holes, we are actually again coating with the zinc paint to avoid some corrosions in the futures, because we are giving warranty of 25 years, which is requested by the market today. So these are all the challenges which is slowing down the productivity, but the cost also reduced, whereas the steel prices going up, all these things are happening. And one more point we would like to include, actually, we are also moving, being a pioneer in roofing solutions, we have several roof profiles with us. We are actually working in collaboration with IIT Madras in designing the rooftop solar system. Just for the information, I'm giving this.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Suresh ji, for your insights. Aditya, what do you think about the role of technology and how would it contribute to overall green challenges and opportunities?
Exactly. So the technology advancement, these things, these I would suggest, if let's say there's 100 number in a company, 30%, 40% people should be dedicated to complete technology research and development. That's how the brand can actually work, innovate, work according to the changes happening in terms of, let's say, for example, I would say these days there are different technologies coming up. For example, from the next inverter that we are going to have, there is not going to be any screen on it. It's going to be Bluetooth and Wi-Fi enabled, which will make it accessible from any point where you can see the generation, you can see everything related to the inverter, you can switch on, off it, everything can be done accordingly. And
that's what.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Aditya. Raghuramji, what do you think about overall off-grid market, and what do you think it would have an impact on the target, growth, opportunities, and challenges?
Now, before starting, I want to recollect the words given by Mr. Vineet, ki all the solar module manufacturers in India are relatively facing a tough time. Am I right, Vineet? That's what we were discussing earlier. Now, coming way back to like 5 to 6 years back, or let us say 10 years back, when JNNSM has been introduced in India, and government has started like giving initiatives to start the Indian people to start the module manufacturing in India. But even that time, if I recollect, the people were facing the like tough time in India to module manufacturer. And even today, the people who are at that time, there were only 4 to 5 people who are manufacturing modules. Now there are so many people, I can rate it as 50 plus people, the companies in manufacturing in modules in India. Even that time people faced tough time, even today the module manufacturing people, they are facing tough times. Relatively, when the off-grid market has been imposed by government by giving certain incentives, there were the place where Indian module manufacturers have been picked up in the market. So mostly, as per my understanding, the solar industry has been divided into two segments, basically, if I say. One is off-grid, one is grid-tie. And I can say exactly ki the Indian module manufacturer, mostly, as a module manufacturer, I say, we are concentrating mostly on the off-grid applications. Like off-grid applications, as the government is giving incentives for that and subsidy to install the product for the Indian module manufacturers, they get 30% subsidy to some extent. So in this case, as a module manufacturer, I say I am concentrating on the off-grid applications with rooftop, like solar pumping solutions, standalone solutions. And that is where at least 30% of the government targeted volume in India for solar, 30 to 40% of the off-grid market should contribute, wherein the Indian solar module manufacturers can even compete with China by supplying the modules.
Thank you. Thank you. Great insights. I feel gone are those days when our country was known for magicians and tigers. Now our country is known for technologists. So as Aditya mentioned that we should have 30% of manpower focusing on technology, I would like to flip the numbers. We are known for a country of technologists. We should have more and more people. We have a pool of talent in our country if we invest the way we just said. Instead of competing with ourselves, doing the same business by all of us and cutting each other's margins, we could probably start thinking what else can be done, what more can I bring in, what problem can I solve, and all of these talented people all around us would be able to build innovative solutions. That probably, if you want to become a leader in the market, probably would have to flip the numbers to make India as the leader. We build the technology, and that balance 30% would actually take this technology to the rest of the world, and the world could probably start following up with us. With these innovations happening in off-grid market, there are a lot of products which are getting developed all around. These products being explored, tested, utilized is going to give us a benefit. If we all keep speaking, there are plenty of subjects and all experts on the dais would not stop. So would like to open up the floor for the public, for the audience, and check if you have any doubts and queries in your mind which we would like which you would like panelists to answer.
Yes, sir.
Can we have a mic, please? My request to all the audience, whichever question, if you could specify for whom you, the question is, would still be helpful. Otherwise, you could leave an open question. All the experts could take it up.
Importing in China, that is cheaper, isn't it? So why the China government is any monetary benefit is giving or technology development is giving? See, in India, I attend one meeting. India is importing tons of gold, but they are importing tons of technology. China. That's why they are bringing the cost down. The what we are doing it, what is the government is doing, the technology or monetary? What you are expecting from the government?
See, you...
I got a thought before. See, we are in this stage in India doing model business. It's 90% more of a government, right? If I'm correct, government is encouraging for that. So you can carry on to that.
See, per se, if you look at the industry, worldwide, this industry is being controlled by the government. It's just not that it is happening in India alone. Internationally,
controlling by the government means it's not allowing to manufacture lesser cars?
No, it's not the question of government not allowing it. See, no, it's not the...
Vinitji, if you don't mind, can I take this up?
That's what.
Yeah, see, I got your point. See, for that you have to look from the a very broader perspective. See, we started around 7-8 years back, and things actually started happening around 5 years back only. Whereas China has already taken a march over us. It's not just because of the numbers what they are producing or they are generating. And top of it, whatever capacities the manufacturing base in India is having, there only a single player is having that kind of capacity. And moreover, they are having a vertically integrated groups over there. And the quantum, and they are earning into volumes as well. So they are able to invest more into the R&D as well. And thirdly, there are hidden and indirect subsidies also being provided by the Chinese government to these people. And they also encourages the export also. So apart from the top line, their bottom line is also very robust. So they are able to reroute that money into R&D and other things, and plus because of the volumes they have been able to take.
Sorry to interrupt you, Vinitji. Sorry to interrupt you here.
If you say the Chinese company's bottom line is good,
yeah,
then you please refer to the latest Bloomberg report. 70-80% of the Chinese body manufacturing
companies. But those are the
companies are closing down, and the closing down factor is one company per week.
That's true,
these
sir.
Are two completely different factors.
But sir, but
what we will have to discuss
sir, but
here
that is not pertaining to the topmost manufacturers. If you see the last 3-4 yeah. So, but they are controlling the main market, sir.
But here the basic point, I would like to come from a different point of view.
Okay.
My name is Dilip. I am a private consultant. I've been in the industry for 15 years and now I'm involved. See, the Indian mentality itself is not the same. Let us come to it. Because the simplest reason why India is not able to compete with China in any industry, any sector, is that we don't do it. India had such a huge, I think my wife, I don't think that.
It would help some corners.
In the textile sector, in the dairy sector, Tirupur was leading the world. In Tamil Nadu, it was 70% of the t-shirts in the world. Why it has lost market share? The government hasn't done anything against that. In fact, when they are polluting the entire river after river in Tamil Nadu, they are just looking quite well. The government could have closed down all the companies there. The government has supported them, they didn't take any action to stop them. I'm going to work, but Indians don't feel that has been a problem. Because we always feel that somebody else has to do something for us. What the government has done for me, you do something which is a top. You see that the exact simple thing, I'm digressing entirely, but I just want to hire a recycle partner. So budget comes, starting for a senior budget, are you just me here? Totally budget.
Sorry to interrupt you, but we'd like to bring the discussion back to the point. So please.
We want everything to be done for us. We won't take a simple step to do anything for anything. And we don't think big.
That's right.
We cannot say that we don't think big.
I say this for only one person and only one company has thought and developed a world class.
That is
sir, we all have different views.
Indian doesn't think this then.
Only one company. Make out any, take the brains out and look at it.
Sir,
please, sir.
No, it's not
sir,
a debate with you.
Sir,
please, gentlemen, please. Can I request you to not to get into the debate or argument mode? And we are here to have a healthy argument. Can I request you to please allow to discussion to move forward? I really appreciate your views. Each one of us would have different views, different experiences, and different perceptions to everything. Couple of things that we just discussed, you know, I have just a small comment on that, is when we're comparing India and China, we're not comparing apples with apples. We're probably comparing apples with oranges. Some of these bankruptcies that we have heard, what comes in the newspaper or what comes in the media is exception and not what's the broad concept. Again, would not like to get into the debate and argument of it, but just would like to tell you that for last more than 20 years, and out of which more than 15 years, China has become a manufacturing hub. And forget about solar, practically every industry, every product, industrial components, spare parts, consumer products, luxury products, what and what not. Most of the biggest of the brands across the world, including brands in Europe and US, have their manufacturing hubs in China. So versus India, which is a pool of talent, if you see even today, I have got a little exposure to work in 72 countries of the world, and every country that I have personally been to, I have been fortunate to meet at least few Indians or people from Indian origin at the senior most top level. And the reason I always believe that this country has a pool of talent is the that we have is completely different than what they have. They have a culture of repetitive tasks and we like to do innovative things. So instead of copying what someone else has done, if we follow ourselves, build that innovation for ourselves and the growth of country, we can probably go far ahead of China in a completely different way than following their steps. Again, how much of government can support? Government probably would force to support if we do something different. If we build the size and scale, things will automatically get into the flow that things will have to be done and so on. But I'm sure all of us would have different perceptions and views. Even some of us might not agree to my views because those are my personal views with my personal experiences. Let's move on to the next. Can we have the next question? Yes, please wait for Mike.
Hello. Yeah, Tata Blue School, I think you have put two grades of structures, one for 150 microns, other one is, I think, 500 microns. Which one do you recommend for coastal areas? Because India has got a large coastal belt. So structures we have got to last for 25 years. I have seen some structures in some coastal area. Within 7 years, it is not there. Structure is practically corroded.
Yeah.
It went good coating to gamma and all that, but you're telling this. Two grades, which one you recommend?
Our own product is a zinc alum coated steel, which I explained already, which is our standard product coated on top of steel, which is having 150 GSM. Okay, for coastal area, we have another coating mass is called 200 GSM, which is called ultra zinc alum. So that will that we are recommending for all the coastal regions. Basically, zinc alum itself 4 times greater than the regular galvanized steel, and this ultra will add on to that actually further durable than regular zinc alum.
Normally for all our sites we use around 80 micron of hot dipping. in case of these kind of sites, we use the 120 micron. The design should be of 120, so that steel design, everything should be designed as per the this one. So if you do hot dip of 120 and above, this can able to withstand that much time.
Thank you. To keep the agenda on the track, would like to have last two questions, if any. We have a question there.
It's to Tata Blusco. They said for 1 megawatt, they've designed a structure with 26 tons of steel structures. Is it for tracking or a fixed mounting?
No, it's for fixed and manual tilting, not for trackers.
Not for trackers.
One last question, please. All right, I guess no more questions. Like to thank all the experts and panelists on the dais for sharing their valuable time and their knowledge and views with the audience. And thank you, audience, for being a wonderful audience to make the session interactive.
So thank you, everyone. Thank you to all the panelists. I think we have again got back on time. So I would like to take this opportunity to present some small tokens of appreciation to all the fellow panelists. Can we have the gifts, please? And I'll request Mr. Sunil Joshi, the session moderator, to present them to the panelists. Mr. Aditya
sir,
from
camera,
SunGrow India. We have Mr. Vineet Tyagi from Insulation Energy. Mr. Raghu from Navitas Solar. Mr. Suresh Raj from Tata Blusco. Mr. Pradeep Srikanthan from Reddington, India. And I'll request Pradeep ji to present the token of appreciation to Sunil sir.